We'll start Nathan's second lecture. Before that, I just want to announce that Gary Stormo has donated a book to the school, which is Introduction to Protein-DNA Interactions, which includes the stuff that he was talking about here. And this book will be available for you at the desk outside, whoever wants to look at it and read it and so on. And please take it from there and put it back there. And then eventually this book will go to the library, to the ICTS library. But it's available for us to use in this school. So let's thank Gary for this donation. And Nathan.
Okay. Just going to get rid of a little bit of this cord. It's kind of long. All right, perfect. All right, day two. So I thought what we'll do, first I'll finish what I meant to talk about yesterday, and then we'll go through some of the new material, and then we'll finish up whatever we need to tomorrow and go through research. So I thought I would back up just a few slides so we get a little bit of a running start. So just to remind you that what we talked about last time was the process essentially of building out one of these big biochemical networks that essentially serves as a knowledge base either for an organism or a community or whatever it is that you're trying to reconstruct. As we talked about, you take these metabolic networks, you can represent them in the form of a stoichiometric matrix, and then we can start applying mathematics on top of them. We talked about the basic equation, mass conservation, which is just S times V equals zero. All that means is that the rate of production and the rate of consumption of every metabolite internal to the cell is assumed to be zero, so it's assumed to be balanced, assumed to be at a steady state. And then we have our reaction flux bounds, and then we apply thermodynamic constraints. And this gives us a solution space. And so what's really important to remember in constraint-based modeling is that you're not solving for the state of the cell, you're solving for the range of possible states that doesn't violate the measurements that you've made or the stoichiometry, or the enzyme capacities, or the thermodynamics that you know. And that's what we're going to go through today. So we talked about this yesterday, sort of the mathematics of how this is formed. As I mentioned, the S times V equals zero gives us this infinite hyperplane. If we decouple all the reactions into a forward and reverse direction, that makes all the fluxes positive. That takes your infinite hyperplane and it wraps it into this convex cone. And then you cap it with Vmax, that gives you this bounded convex substrate. And today I'll actually take you through an exact calculation of this for a really simple system so you can see exactly where this comes from. Okay. And then today we're going to talk about how to run models on top of these kind of networks. And so I took you very briefly through this range of applications. And what we're going to do today is just step through these in detail in just a minute. And then I took you right at the end of last time through this clock diagram that just has a number of the different methods that have been developed for this field. And they group into two major classes, one of which is objective-based methods. This is where you have to assume some sort of objective function for a cell, like it's optimizing its growth rate, and you pick out solutions that are within a certain small aspect of the space. And then we'll also talk about unbiased methods, where you don't assume any sort of objective for the cell, but you just simulate all the possible states that are in agreement with the amount of experimental data you have. Okay, and we're going to walk through that. Objective-based methods are most commonly used for microbes, especially microbes in the lab, because if you do a simple experiment and you passage cells every day, then that puts them under strong selection pressure for optimizing growth rate. So that ends up being a pretty good assumption in a lab. It's not such a great assumption if you're looking at, say, a metagenome or something out there in the wild. And then unbiased methods are also really useful for things like human systems, where you can't assume that you're optimizing growth. That's very rarely the case. And so here you're just evaluating properties based on the measurements you've made, and that's what we'll go through now. Okay. Any questions on any of that before we dive into the new stuff? No? Okay. All right, so let's talk about optimization. So whenever you solve for this equation, so this S times V equals zero, V lies in what's called the null space of S, okay, if you remember back to your linear algebra. And so every point within the null space is a solution to a steady state for that network, okay? So so if we have, let's just draw up our trivial little example here again. So if we have like a simple network like this around any particular metabolite, so let's say we have a flux, say, of 3 coming in here, 2, 2, 1. So something like this would lie in the null space because we have, I'll explicitly write this out, A, B, and C. So if we have some sort of metabolite, right, that's being made at a rate of, say, 3 millimolar per hour, right, then around A, all we're doing is saying that 3 equals 2 plus 1, right, and around B, 2 equals 2, and around C, 1 plus 2 equals 3. Okay, so anything where that holds, where it balances, that's the solution to the null space. If, on the other hand, for some reason, we had this were a 3, for example, then you start having imbalances. This would be an example of a solution that would cause B to be continuously accumulated, and this would not lie within the null space of S. Is that clear? So pretty simple. So all you're doing, and then you have your boundaries, right, so that everything that's internal to the cell is assumed to be at steady state if you're in the null space, and the only changes that you have are external. So you have a rate coming from some A external, which typically in these models is not, there's no concentration represented here. You can do it if it's in a batch culture. But essentially, you have some rate of A that's being depleted from some medium, and you have some accumulation of C external. So you're just looking at a rate of consumption, a rate of production, and then these all internally balance. That's all that S times V equals zero means. So it's a matrix equation. It just does this across thousands of reactions at the same time. Yes. And we can talk about cycles. So if you have, so there's two different kinds of cycles you can have. It depends on which one you're talking about. There are cycles where, like the TCA cycle, where you know you have a bunch of reactions that are going, but you have some change in a cofactor. These are what are called, actually you can break these down into what are called extreme pathways. This is a type 2 extreme pathway. Or you can have cycles that really take you from state A back to state A. If you have something like this, these are energetically infeasible because there's no way to go from state A to state B without having a zero change in free energy, right? Because free energy is a state function. So these kind of loops, typically you're just trying to get rid of them, not let them be in solutions. These kind of loops are operational in biology all the time, but they have to run energetically downhill. In other words, this has to go ATP, you know, to ADP, but it can't go in the opposite because these, it's like a battery running down. And so these are futile cycles. Okay. So there's a number of different loops and cycles you go through. So everything that lies in the null, so every point in here lies in the null space of S, which means that it's a steady state solution. It's a steady state that's possible within the network. And so you have a high-dimensional space. The axes here are just all the different metabolic fluxes. And it's kind of a weird term. I should have said this last time. This field always talks about a metabolic flux for a reaction rate. And it's mostly just because we're always drawing diagrams like this. So it, you know, conceptually, it looks like flux. But if you're used to mass transfer, it has nothing to do with that. So it is kind of an odd nomenclature, but it's very common in this field. So you have this metabolic reactions, your metabolic flux, the null space, and then any particular point in that space is a particular solution, a particular state of that network, like the one I drew up here. And in this case, right, if you're looking for an optimum, then that will typically drive you to a particular corner of the space or a particular edge, and we'll talk about that in more detail. Any questions about that? So that's just the concept of what this null space is, or it's also referred to as the steady state flux space. Uh-huh. Right. So if you have a cycle where there's no cofactors driving it, like literally you're just going around a set of reactions that brings you back to an identical state, what that means is, right, I'll draw it out a little more explicitly, right? So you have some set of reactions that if you run them all would bring you back to the same state. You can't actually have any net flux around this loop because there's no driving force, right? Because your driving force is a free energy change. Right? So you have to have a free energy drop for a reaction to proceed. And there's no way to sum up these free energy. You can't sum up a bunch of negative numbers to equal zero, basically, right? And so you can't actually have net flux here. Where that becomes important is that, let's say this was a, you know, if this here was a reversible reaction, for example, you could have, you know, 3 units in, 3 coming out, but this cycle, if you allowed it to run, you could have, you know, this could be 1,003, 1,003, and 997, or it could be 1,000,000, you know, right? You could infinitely add any number if you allowed these cycles to go. Does that make sense? It would all balance mass, but it's not energetically feasible. I haven't really gotten there, but since there was a question.
But
yeah. Yeah, stem cells can't violate thermodynamics either. What's the question? No, this has nothing to do with stem cells. This is reaction rate. So stem cells, right, stem cells just have a property where, right, they divide and they form one of themselves, right, and they form a daughter cell. But this has to be thermodynamically driven too. I mean, they kind of visually look the same, but it's nothing like this. What's the difference between this and a stem cell? A stem cell doesn't come, a stem cell is eating food, okay? A stem cell has energy input into it, and it's also secreting things. So it has an energy driver. So when a stem cell has to divide and it has to make a daughter cell, it can't do that without energy. So it is not operating at all like a cycle. It's much more, it's more, actually, it's not even like this. It's what it would be classified as what's a type 1 pathway. In other words, it's taking in substrates, breaking them down for energy, so it has energy to drive the remaking of itself. But in no way is a stem cell, there's no stem cell that's just sitting there looping back to itself. Right? And even a stem cell that divides into another copy of itself in another cell is not coming back to exactly the same, to the same state. This is saying that you come back in exactness. Every single concentration, every single state chemically is exactly the same when you go around a cycle like this. Like there's absolutely no change. Does that make sense? No? Yeah.
So this example on the right, I agree that you can see that somehow thermodynamics is violated. But is there a generalization to an arbitrary network? Like something you can look at and say that
Oh yeah, so you can compute all these. I don't think I put it in this one, but there's something that's called energy balance analysis that was developed by Dan Beard, who's at the Medical College of Wisconsin. And essentially you can, and it's analogous to the S times V equals zero equation, but it's based, but you derive it instead from chemical potentials. And you can identify all of these loops. It actually is a pretty hard problem. In fact, I worked on that a little bit back in grad school, and we came up with methods where we could identify all the loops that were in like a genome scale network, or at least for someone like H. pylori, which was one of the smaller ones we could do. I think E. coli we could never quite get it all computed. Been a little while since I went through exact details of that, but you can, there's a whole bunch of tricks you can use to make it go faster. I haven't introduced you to all the methods. But one of the ways that you can identify cycles is we're going to talk in a minute about something called flux variability analysis. and it will probe what is the max and min that's possible through every reaction. If this is reversible, so I have this possibility of a cycle here, when I say what's the max that this reaction can get, it will always be able to hit its global max. So if I have some limiting substrate, and I make the Vmax on all these other internal reactions like 10,000 or something, if they are participating in a loop, you'll be able to hit the 10,000 because you can arbitrarily, by mass balance, change this to be any number you want. You see that? So if this is a loop, is there an eraser here somewhere? Yeah. So if this is in a loop, then I can balance mass here by saying this is a 1,000. Right, this could be 1,003. This could be 1,003. And this would be going in this direction, 997. Okay, and arbitrarily I could change this to any value I wanted, right? Because I could make this 10,003, 10,003, 9,996. You see what I mean? So as soon as you have one of these loops, then every reaction here can take on like any arbitrary value. So one of the ways. It's going. Oh, because I added the 3 already. You're right, I'm sorry. You're right, thank you. I already added the 3, I did it twice. Right, so you'd have 1,003, right, thank you. Yeah. 3 minus from 1,003, so you'd have that, right? But arbitrarily, you can add, you know, whatever number you wanted. So one of the ways that you can tell if you have a loop is you can run a linear program that just finds the absolute max and min. We're gonna talk about this in next couple slides, but basically, you can get a max and a min on this reaction. And if it's not in a loop like this one, it'll tell us 3 is the max, right? Because that's what's coming in. If it's in a loop, it'll say this can go to whatever arbitrary huge number you put in. And so you can identify very rapidly all the reactions that are involved in a loop. That reduces your search space generally from, say, maybe you have 1,500 reactions and you find out, okay, there are 30 that operate in a loop. And then within that 30, it turns out to be an NP complete problem. Then enumerate like all the possible cycles that could exist there. And that becomes a little tricky because you don't actually want to get rid of any of these reactions, right? Because it's perfectly valid to have a flow that comes up here, and it's perfectly valid to have a flow through the bottom. Those are both perfectly valid solutions. So to get rid of this loop, you can't just do it by getting rid of reactions. Okay, so you have to do it when you solve the equation. If you're doing linear programming, it's not a problem because the simplex algorithm already minimizes the fluxes. Another thing that people often do is you can apply a constraint so that you minimize the summation of fluxes through a network. And if you do that, it will force all of these to go to their minimum state. And that's actually the easiest way to deal with loops. Does that make sense? I'm saying that deals with one thermodynamic problem. That does not deal with all your thermodynamic problems. I'm just saying that these so-called type 3 pathways are infeasible. Something like this, which is like the type 2, then it depends on this energetic state, right? So everything that's changing, the ATP to ADP, you know, plus phosphate and water, right? That's a downhill reaction, and so this is okay. But to do it in the opposite direction wouldn't be okay because your net change is going uphill. So getting rid of loops is just the very beginning of getting thermodynamics. It's not the end. And in fact, that's a much more challenging area. Mass balance comes out a lot cleaner. Energy balances turn out to be pretty complicated because we know a lot of the standard free energies, but we don't know a lot of the free energies in the living system. And there are all kinds of ways you can estimate that, and there's a huge amount of work that's being done in that area. But there's a lot of need to kind of work that out. Yeah, that part is not simple. I mean, the basic math of it is all known, right? You don't know what the you don't know what the parameters are. Okay. All right, so here, this is just a two-dimensional view of this solution space. And so what you have typically is there's some direction. So in this case, this is the direction. I apologize, it's a little hard to read. This is your direction of better survival or optimal growth or whatever it is. You have some pressure, and that would push your solutions into this corner. And what you can observe during evolutions in the lab, for example, our strains will kind of get better and sort of gravitate towards these points if they're set up the right way. Okay. All right, so one of the things that we do then here is we can calculate, we can do linear programming, okay? And so in linear programming then, we just set some objective function z, and it equals some weighting, and c is just a weighting of you know, whatever you want, on top of your reaction rates, your fluxes, these are Vs. So this C times V, and then you minimize Z. And essentially what you're doing is you're just optimizing for something in the network. Okay, and this is linear programming, most commonly run algorithm in the world, I think, still. And there's a whole bunch of questions that you can address using linear programming. Okay? So for example, you can have your network and you can ask, what is the state of growth that would minimize ATP production or maximize ATP production? What would minimize a nutrient uptake or a redox production? Or this is the one I just mentioned, or the... Okay. Okay. And then maximization, usually the most common objective function that we use is... at least in microbes, is maximizing biomass production, but you can also maximize metabolite production, right? So maybe you want to ask a question like, I want this yeast cell to optimally eat both 5 and 6 carbon sugars simultaneously and output butanol that I'm going to build a company around or something like that, right? And so you can ask questions like that and come up with optimal solutions. Okay. So this is what this objective function looks like. So we typically are minimizing some objective function z, which is these weightings, c times the vector of fluxes shown here. So for example, if we had these fluxes here, so we had some reaction through glucose-6-phosphate, fructose-6-phosphate, ATP, NADH, then you just set c, in this case just 0, 0, a -1 and 0, so you're going to minimize this -1. And so that means that z is equal to 0 times all these, and so you have -1 times VATP, so you have the -1 times the -1. So you get this -1 VATP, and so if you minimize z, that would in fact maximize ATP production. All right, so it's set up pretty simply. Any questions about that? So you just define what the objective is. Now, typically what we do, as I started talking about yesterday, is you have growth requirements for the cell. And so as soon as, so we might have some measurement of the amount of ATP, NADH, NADPH, et cetera, that is in the cell. And you take all of those, and essentially you just build one big objective function. Okay? All right, so you just take that coefficient times the flux of ATP, this amount times the amount of NADH, NADPH, and so forth. And these are all being added as exchanges, okay? So this is all flowing out of this system, okay? That's why there's not, right, it's not an accumulation within the system, but we just say this is the amount that has to be produced, right? So this is a weight on fluxes, not concentrations. And then when you build your objective function in this way, that's what ties your whole network together. So now you have to simultaneously make all these, and that puts a lot more integration into the network. You're not just needing to make one component. Yeah?
How do you make sure that you don't get a cell that's making itself totally? So this looks like I could.
This looks like I could have a lot of ATP production and no NADPH.
No, that's not true at all. Because actually, z is equal to all of these things. So it's actually forcing it to make an exact ratio of 41.2570 V ATP minus 3.547 V. Like, this is considered the optimal ratio that it's trying to achieve. So that will set a direction, and it will get as close to this as it can. Because you're optimizing this entire function at the same time.
You're not trying to minimize Z?
Oh, I'm sorry. I see what you're saying. Actually, it's really a good point. So the way that this is set up is a little confusing. If you're right, if I only set up the objective function this way, actually, I should fix this slide. This is shown a little bit wrong in terms of how it's usually done. This is a great point. Because the way it's set up here, actually, I totally agree with you, right? You could just say, I'm making a huge amount of VATP because that's going to, give me a big Z. So what we actually do, and I should have said it this way, is we create a new reaction. So we set up a reaction that is all of these things makes one biomass, and then typically what we do is maximize that biomass. So actually, I got to fix this slide. That's a great catch. This is that's misleading. No, great point, because that the way it's written, you would be exactly right. And so what we in fact do is set up one big reaction. So this should say that we have, I'll show it in a minute, that we have all of these things create one biomass. We turn that into one giant reaction. And then in the C coefficients, we typically just have 0, 0, 0, 0, and then just a negative 1 saying maximize that function. And that's what forces them to be in the same ratio. Yeah, thanks for that catch. I'll have to remember to change that. Okay, and so basically what that represents then is that you have your substrates coming in, and then you're making the cell wall, you're making the nucleotides, the amino acids, the pyrimidines, heme, purines, et cetera, and you have to make them all at the same time. Okay, and that's really the key. All right, so some issues with this that come up as we do this. One issue is that biomass composition varies from one organism to another. And there's actually a pretty small number of organisms for which we have a reasonably well-measured biomass composition. And so when people do new organisms, like I talked about yesterday, you end up trying to estimate it. You can estimate it from the genome and the transcriptome and the proteome, and you can, you know, maybe there's some guesses you can make based on lipid composition and so forth, but this is really a challenging. It can also vary from one growth condition to another. So even for a particular organism, depending on the rate of growth, you can have a different biomass composition. In a lot of the calculations, they're not super sensitive to that, so you end up getting pretty reasonable predictions even though you don't know all that. But trying to take all this into account explicitly would be, you know, the correct way to do it. So the optimum doesn't change that much. As I was just mentioning, with changes in a composition of a class of macromolecules, like the amino acid composition of protein, but it matters a lot more just sort of like how much, you know, percentage protein is there in this particular organism. And the optimum does change if the relative composition of the major macromolecules changes, just like I just said. So that matters. Okay. Anyway, so that's an introduction to how we look at objective function-based analysis in these solution spaces. So if we come back here then to the plot that I've been showing, we just went through some of these, a first pass to what these objective-based methods are like, but there's a whole suite of methods that are developed around this that I'll take you through now. Okay, so here's just a very simple plot, I hope, that shows a number of the different questions that you might ask from these solution spaces. So here in blue, this represents, you know, just a two-dimensional, easy picture of what actually is generally a very high-dimensional space. So for something like E. coli, this is like a 200-dimensional space or something like that. And so if you have this space of possibilities, then you can probe it in a lot of different ways using linear programming and different optimization techniques. So right here, you can do linear programming, as I mentioned. And if we say up here is our increase in objective function, right? So up is better on this plot. This is just defined arbitrarily there. Then if you ran a linear program, it would pick one of these two solutions. Now, what's important is that if you run the simplex algorithm and you calculate an LP, then you get one of these solutions. Okay? But it's totally arbitrary which one you get. This is really important to understand. So if you're running a flux balance analysis and you optimize for growth, that optimal number, that optimum for growth rate is unique, but the flux distribution internal to the cell, in other words, which of these states it actually picks, is not unique. And that's a mistake that a lot of people make in this field when they first get in it, is they run an FBA and say, okay, here's the state of the cell. No, that's not actually true, because you know, you might have a million of these points and you're picking one of them. Okay, so that's an issue. Now, you can run mixed integer linear programs. These are much more complicated and much more intensive in terms of calculation, but it would pull out, in this case, both of these points. Okay? So you can calculate multiple of these points, but it gets you into a lot more difficulties. A shortcut that a lot of people use, it's not perfect, but it is helpful, is something called flux variability analysis. And so flux variability analysis would minimize V1 and maximize V1. So and you can do that subject to being constrained to the maximum value. So you can say, you can constrain your calculation to say, okay, I'm going to be at the maximum value, and then you run a secondary linear program to minimize and maximize V1, and that tells you the range of V1 that is allowable for you to be able to operate at the optimum. Because it's these two points in this particular case are also not the only optima, right? Every single point in between is also an optimal flux distribution, okay? It's just some non-negative combination of the two vectors here, right? And so you just come up with this whole line. So flux variability says that V1 can be anywhere within this range while you're still achieving, say, maximum growth. Okay. Any questions about that? Does that make sense? And this turns out to be very useful because you can run this for V1, then you can run it for V2, for V3, for V4, for V5. We'll talk about that in a minute. And essentially, you're just creating a big box around your solution space, but you know the range of every reaction. We'll talk more about that in a minute. You can also do this in the reverse direction. Let's say you just measured that your cell is operating here, that this is the flux distribution that you measure. You can then also compute the range of all the possible objective functions that are being maximized for you to operate at that position. You just, that's just a linear program. So you're just, you just set that as the objective function. So just like we set biomass as the objective function, you just say, you know, when you say minimize Z, Z is just, you just put your -1 next to V1. And so it turns out to be a pretty simple calculation. So you go minimum, you go maximum, and then that just gives you this range, right, that corresponds to, you know, that position and that position. Yeah.
Is that really true that you can measure where a cell is on one of these graphs well enough to say what's the optimum?
Sure. Now, typically what you do is you're probably looking at a projection of the space, because you can't actually measure all the fluxes accurately so that you would know your position in a hyperdimensional space, most likely. But you could certainly, if you have a projection of the space, though, you could certainly measure what's my glucose uptake rate, how much oxygen is it consuming, how much CO2 is it making, and so forth. And in that subspace, then, yeah, you would measure this. And I'll show you some actual data like that, too.
But really, that's enough to say that...
Well, yeah, I mean, because all you're doing here is you're just looking at the vectors. I mean, all this is... So in this case, right, this, if you're near this corner, for example, then you would... Well, it's a good point. It's an approximation, I should say, because like here, when we when we're showing these objective functions here, we are kind of assuming that you're operating at that corner, I guess, more so than like internal. There are ways to do this. There's you can do internal. Well, I probably shouldn't get into this because I can't go too far on this. I'm forgetting how this one goes. There are ways to do internal point calculations. That gets really complicated. We had this great professor that visited us. This is a long time ago, like 10 years ago, that had come up with some methods to do that, who's at the University of Colorado at Denver. And I'm blanking his name right now. It'll come to me in a minute. Anyway, so here, but if you see something like this and you say, all right, as an approximation, it's operating at this, near this, vertice, then it's not too hard to calculate the objective functions. This is work from Kostas Maranis at Penn State, so he's the one that developed this particular method. It's not my method, it's his method. But in essence, all you're doing is whatever is exactly parallel to this line, anything that's inside that and anything that's inside, you know, this line coming down parallel, every direction there would lead you to optimize at this point. So yes, in many cases you can predict, you can calculate this as the potential objective functions. So you can get your ranges of that. Anyway. Typically you would only know a few dimensions, but you could calculate the objective function in those dimensions. Right? So you couldn't say maybe everything about internal to the cell, but you could say it seems to optimize a ratio of between 4-to-1 oxygen to glucose to 2-to-1 oxygen to glucose. Any of those would be an optimal objective function, for example. So it's a great question, actually. So you are typically calculating this in a lower dimensional space.
So, for example, if I'm breathing
carbon dioxide, you're not optimizing carbon dioxide intake, right? Or carbon fixation or things like that. That's right. No, that's a great question. Okay, cool. All right, so we can look at this now in three dimensions. So same thing here. This is something called a phenotypic phase plane. And so in essence, here we're just looking at the solution space. This is projected into three dimensions. So in this case, it's succinate uptake, it's oxygen uptake, and then this is just the biomass production. Right, the maximum possible. And then this red line here is what's called the line of optimality. So this represents the optimum, this is the optimum yield of biomass. So this is the optimum ratio of succinate to O2 for making biomass is along this particular line. Okay. And then you can project it down into two dimensions, right? This is biomass production versus oxygen, or biomass production versus succinate uptake. And this point here turns out to be corresponds to the line of optimality once it's projected down. So this would tell us that this is sort of the optimum succinate in this case. Okay. All right, no questions about that? All right, we'll come back to that in a minute. You can also, as I mentioned yesterday, do dynamic simulations. And so here with the dynamic simulations, and you might ask yourself, how can we do dynamics since I told you already that we do steady state? And so the way that we do that is you make a pseudo steady state assumption at every point in time. So, for example, so if we're looking here at a batch culture, we might start with 100 of this A external, and we start with, say, 0 of this C external. Then you, if this is 3 millimolar per minute or something like this, you step forward 1 minute, then you've now consumed 3, and presumably you've made 3, right? So at minute 1, you would then say, all right, I've got 97 of A external left, and I now have 3 of C external. It's kind of trivial in this case, because there's only 1, so it's just going to gradually decline. But that's the point. So you can just, so you update these externalities, which is what you have represented on this plot, and then you just compute. So here, right, so like I said, so you divide time into these several small time steps. The result of the previous step determine FBA inputs for next step. Because what will happen here, it's kind of trivial in this case, but if we have multiple different inputs, at one point you'll run out of oxygen, or you'll run out of glucose, Right, you'll run out of glucose and then you'll switch and say, okay, now I'm going to use fructose or whatever it is. Okay, and so when you do that, then in essence, you're assuming this quasi-steady state at every point. And when this has been compared to experiment, you can actually get fairly reasonable kinds of prediction. You can see this is not by any means a perfect prediction, but not bad in terms of the experimental measurements and how they correspond to a model derived from just sort of simple flux balance. So it gives you a way to simulate batch cultures. This can be done really nicely. In fact, a former postdoc of mine, Amit Ghosh, did kind of a nice model like this, where we were able to simulate a batch culture for a new engineered design of yeast that would enable it to metabolize a 5-carbon sugar. And we tested what would matter if we went through like the year-long engineering effort of doing cofactor balancing, because the way the pathway was, one part of it used NADPH and the other part used NADH. And it turned out that the simulation showed with this kind of an approach that if you balance the cofactors so that you created NADH and then consumed it so it didn't put any burden on the rest, I'm going to forget exactly how this goes, but it was something like predicted a 25% increase in the amount of ethanol you got at the end of the batch culture, and then it would be 5 hours faster or something like that. And that kind of prediction can come out of this kind of calculation. So you're not necessarily decreasing the flux rate, typically, although you could be, depending on how you set it up. But usually what's happening is that there is a, usually you're running into constraints. And so you can do this in different ways. So if you want to, you can set up a way so that this, you can set it up so that this is proportional to that external concentration. Right? So you can do it that way. Or sometimes you just set it up where there's some sort of relatively constant pull, but when you run out of certain substrates, then it'll cause you to have a shift. So there's different ways you can set that up. But that's a good question. Mm-hmm. So in this kind of setting, you are updating like what's out here. So eventually you run out of substrate. If you made these sort of infinite, then you're kind of back to our basic calculation, right? Then you're not really simulating a batch, you're just simulating. That's what we do. Like when we don't have any of these concentrations, that's essentially what we're saying. We're just saying there's an infinite source and there's an infinite sink, and you're just looking at balances. Yeah, so in the model, okay, so in reality, of course, that happens. In the model, the way that it's set up currently, you can't have any accumulation internally. So if you want to simulate that, so like if we're looking at, say, PHA accumulation in yeast, then what you do is you set up a pseudo exchange flux. So this isn't actually crossing the cell, but you would say, okay, I want to maximize for, or I want to study PHA accumulation, but you would just have it cross the boundary and then just set it, and then it would just be sort of set up. Does that make sense? So when we put in the system these kind of exchanges, they don't necessarily correspond to something crossing the cell. They could be an accumulation term. Okay. And just like it could be ATP, like if you're maximizing for ATP, you just because you could have exchanges also that have ATP going out and then ADP, PI, phosphate coming in, and then you're just essentially saying, how fast could I turn over the production of ATP in the system, right? So you can do a lot of games like that. So that's why these models, even though they start out really simple, there's actually a lot of interesting questions you can ask with them. They turn out to be very powerful that way. Yeah.
The internal flux distribution in the example that you gave remains constant, right? Across this across time?
The flux distribution, not necessarily. The concentrations are all fixed, right? Because there's it's a balance. But the internal flux distribution could change.
Because
if there's a change in what's coming across, right? If there's a change in uptake, for example, or you run out of a particular substrate, like the flux distribution will definitely change.
Yes, so...
The concentrations that don't change, right?
Yes, so that's okay. A discrete change. Until, for example, glucose runs out, the flux, internal fluxes remain the same. And then when glucose runs out, then that is, while glucose is there, you are looking at a steady state distribution corresponding to glucose being in the external environment. And...
Right, as long as all your substrates are sort of still available.
Yes.
Unless you've added some sort of additional constraints so that it's, you know, because you could set up, if you wanted to, you could tie this in with a really simple kinetic equation, right? You could make uptake proportional to A external or something like that. But if you haven't done that, then yes.
If you haven't done that, then the internal fluxes remain constant until some external substrate runs out.
In that case,
And then you have this, in this case, you're talking about this change, right?
Yeah.
So glucose ran out, right? And then...
So glucose runs out, and then you see that we start then consuming acetate. So as long as it's consuming glucose, it's making acetate, right? And then once glucose runs out, now it consumes the acetate.
Yes. So my question is that in the phase in which glucose is not run out, the internal flux distribution is constant. Then in the next phase, when acetate is being consumed, you again have you have a different flux distribution, which corresponds to acetate uptake.
Yep.
But
yep.
Then in the next phase, that remains constant. Is that correct?
If you haven't set it up so that it's proportional to the,
yes.
Right?
Right.
Then yeah, that must. Then yeah, that's right.
And this way you so you don't worry about the feedback. So you're in the same steady state. Basically, internally the cell is in the same steady state effectively.
If you're doing it that very basic way.
If you're doing it that way.
Yep.
Okay.
That's right. And so one of the things that that you get in this case often is it misses because of that it misses certain things. So if like when you switch substrates. Typically, right, in biology, there's a lag phase, right, because it's got to make the protein machinery for the new substrate. Like, these kind of models don't pick that up. If you add regulation in there, you actually can get a time delay in there, and there are ways to do that. But the base model, yeah, wouldn't pick up some of those subtleties. It would pick up that you're shifting into the next carbon substrate and which one is the next best for optimizing, and you could do it that way. But it wouldn't pick up all those subtleties unless you add some of the further bells and whistles on top of it. Yeah, that's right. Okay. Anyway, so that's a bit about optimal approaches. So now I want to talk a little bit about unbiased approaches. All right, so here again, we have our toy solution space. It's cut, we have a V1 and V2, and they're cut off by V2 max and V1 max, okay, shown here. Now you'll notice here there's no depiction of an objective function. Okay, so this is an unbiased method, so there's no objective function. Up isn't better, down isn't better, we're just analyzing the space. And there's a couple ways to do this. So one is that we can look at something called extreme pathways, which is one area. Every once in a while we'll get onto this subject in my group and my group's always surprised because I know tons of arcane information about this, because this is what I did my thesis on, this kind of stuff. So these, this is all out of work that I did in part. And so basically, an extreme pathway one and extreme pathway two, these are your convex basis vectors, okay? So you can just enumerate all of these what are called extreme pathways for a solution space. This one's simple, it has two. E. coli probably has, you know, I don't even know, a billion of these or something. These blow up. That's why they become really hard to use in big systems. But you can have a weighting on these extreme pathways. So So you have some weighting on extreme pathway 2 plus some weighting on extreme pathway 1. And any combination of these basis vectors will get you to every single point in this space. So one of the ways that you can characterize or study, particularly for smaller systems, is to enumerate all of these basis vectors. And I'll talk about that a little more in a minute. The other thing you can do is just Monte Carlo sample all of this solution space and then just statistically analyze the properties of those solutions. Okay. And so those are sort of two ways, those are two ways that we can evaluate this solution space in an unbiased way. Okay. Any questions about that? All right. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about the sampling approach. So one approach that you can use is an elimination algorithm. We applied this to biology a number of years ago in developing an algorithm for this. And so I just want to show you an exact calculation of what these spaces look like. And I'm going to do it in about the simplest example imaginable, because that's about the limits of what we can visualize nicely. So here we have just a simple flux split. So some reaction is making A, and we have two reactions that are consuming A. And we have a Vmax of 10 coming in, a Vmax of 6 in the upper one here, V1, and a Vmax of 8 for the lower one, V2. Okay, so very simple network. So here's a calculation of the null space. This is what it looks like. Okay, so here, what you see, this is the hyperplane that corresponds to S times V equals 0, which in this case is a very simple equation. It's just V2 plus V1 equals V3. That gives you this hyperplane. And then you can see that it gets cut, right? And it gets cut by, doesn't project quite right. Anyway, you have, this is V3, so you can see here's your plane of Vmax of 10. This is, let's see here, I think this is V2, so it has a plane here at 8, and then V1 where you have a plane here at 6. And so you can, if you can visualize that, that's what's happening. So you're getting, so that hyperplane's being cut by all of these Vmaxes, and that's how you end up with this solution space, right? Which looks a little bit like those cartoon diagrams I was showing you before. You can then compute the null space basis vectors, and you can project then this plane into the two null space basis vectors. So this is B1 and B2. These are the basis vectors for your null space. So this is now in blue here. This is the visualization of this space, but it's just flattened out right onto the basis vectors. And then what we did in this algorithm is you can construct what's called a parallel pipette, which is just like a parallelogram, but in a high-dimensional space. And here it's just a parallelogram, where the parallelogram is parallel to each of the Vs, so V1, V2, and V3. And you can see here that we then project our V min and V max, so from here from 0 to 10, for example. Oops. So we can go here from 0 to 10. So we just cut this, and you end up with this parallelogram, which is the smallest of the parallelograms that contains this particular space. Now you can generate uniform random points then by having a weighting on each of these. You just randomly pick a weighting on V2, or you randomly pick a weighting here on this V1, and then that gives you a point, and you generate very quickly, with no mixing or anything, a uniform random sampled statistically unbiased view of this solution space. Okay. And when you do that, then how we characterize these is then you just do a histogram. So V1, this is a histogram of the solutions that are found, V2, same thing, and V3. And so just to look at how this works, so if you're moving in this space from in the direction of V3 min to V3 max, you start from a point. There's only one possibility if you're sitting here at 0, which of course makes sense. If nothing's flowing in, there's only one solution, right? Nothing's flowing out. And then as that goes up, then you start having more and more possible solutions. You hit a maximum between 6 and 8, because at between 6 and 8, you're maximally flexible in terms of being able to choose to send, you know, as much of the flux through V1 or V2. That's your maximum range. Because as soon as you're higher than 8, you're forced to have some flux in V2. As soon as you're lower than 6, right, you're forced to have flux through V2. And so you have less flexibility in the network. So this means your maximum flexibility of this split happens when you have between 6 and 8 units flowing into this split. And that's what's shown here, right? So you start losing flexibility. You have nothing if 0 comes in. So this gives you essentially what this corresponds to at every point is just the length of the line that's parallel to V3. Okay? And so that gives you a solution space. Make sense? This is shown again just at the simplest example possible, because I just want you to get your head wrapped around it. You then run these in really big networks. Okay. So these histograms then give you a sense for what that space looks like. But there's a problem with this elimination algorithm. And the problem is that whenever you take one space and you enclose it in another, as you go to high dimensions, this internal space becomes a lot smaller than this external space. So just to give you a sense for that, so here's a circle inside of a square, right? So it covers most of the space. Now, if you go to a sphere occupies a lot less of a cube than does a circle, a square. And this is the equation here, actually, for the volume of an n-dimensional hypersphere. So this works for every dimension. And so if you plot this, you take the volume of a sphere divided by the volume of the box, this is what happens. It drops very, very fast. By the time you're at 10 dimensions, you essentially get no hits. And this is what it looks like in a log scale. You know, by the time you have a 35-dimensional space, you know, you're only at 10 to the minus 20th is the amount of that of a circle that touches, right, of a hypersphere that touches the hypercube. So it goes to nothing. So this kind of elimination algorithm, while we spend a lot of time building it, it's useful for small systems. It works really well, and it works very, very fast. It's super fast. But you run into this problem, so it doesn't work in high dimensions. Question? Or no? Okay. So that meant that we had to move to a different approach. And one of the ways that this has been solved is through Markov chain Monte Carlo samplers. So in a Markov chain Monte Carlo sampler, essentially what you do is you start at some point, and then you pick a random direction, and you step a random distance, and you go to the next point. And so essentially, you're just picking a random direction, random distance, and you're just bouncing around in that space. And so as you bounce around in this space, there is a provable property that of something that's called Markov mixing. And when you do Markov mixing, it means that if you allow this to bounce around long enough, eventually you're just as likely to have visited any point as any other. So unlike the elimination algorithm I just showed you, for which the points are independent all along, so you can generate the first 100 points from the elimination algorithm are very usable. In this case, they're not usable. They're biased. But if you allow it to run over a long time, then you end up getting a good mixing, and you get a good uniform sampling of this space. There's a lot of variations of this algorithm. And we ended up using one from 1998, this artificial centering hit and run algorithm, which I won't get into the details here because I don't think it's that important. But essentially, it's a trick for how you do the distance jumping within this space that allows it to mix a lot faster, which made this become feasible. So we're really happy about that. What's funny is that, well, this is kind of a side note, but what's funny in this field is that every couple of years, someone proves a faster way to do this. And I remember I wrote one of the guys that did this, Lacey Lovash was his name at Microsoft, a brilliant guy, has written all these amazing mathematical papers. And I wrote him and said, you know, could I get the code for doing this? And his response was like, oh, he's like, oh, that's interesting. He's like, yeah, I've never, yeah, no one's ever coded this up. You know, they just do these mathematical proofs and they prove that it's the fastest ever, which is why I ended up using this version, because this was the version I could understand. Some of those, the papers where Lacey Lovash proves the next thing, I don't even know what the notation, I've never even seen the notation before. So, and this one was interesting. And in fact, it was also really, the mathematics was really complicated and it was a lot of notation I'd never seen before. But literally there's like one paragraph in one of his review papers says basically the gist of the algorithm is, and explained it. And in that paragraph, we were able to figure out how to code it and then ran it by him and everything. So that was kind of interesting. Okay. Yeah.
If I have a network for E. coli, for example, and there's lots of unknown parameters and looking for the one that grows the fastest, that seems well posed. And I think the example you gave was a neuron that's not trying to grow. Mm-hmm. But it still seems like a neuron's trying to do something and we don't know what it is, but yeah, a random point in this parameter space seems like it's probably not doing anything. And I guess I don't know quite what I'm asking, but...
I think I do, so let me answer it. Maybe not, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it's actually a great question, and today I'm just showing methods. Maybe I will throw it, that would be going back to some old papers to show this. I didn't put any of that in here. The random point before in the wide solution space probably isn't that informative. So in practice, what you do, and I probably should have maybe thrown in a few results slides because it would have been interesting here. So the way that we actually use this is we looked at, for example, cardiac myocytes. And we looked particularly at mitochondria in cardiac myocytes. Now what you can do is that so you start with that random space, but then you get a bunch of measurements. So in our case, we were looking at substrate uptake rates, oxygen uptake rates, and so forth. And as you, everyone that you add, so every time you add something in there, right, so if we're looking at something like this, you make a measurement and it tells you, okay, you're actually operating, at, the actual uptake rate here is 7. Now all of a sudden you are focused in a much smaller one, and you just add those on. And as you keep adding them on, you start having a lot more information. And so what we did in the cardiac myocytes, maybe I'll dig this up because it is pretty interesting. We took like diabetic conditions and non-diabetic conditions and just took characteristic values from data. And when we applied those, we were able to come to a number of really interesting calculations. One was that under the diabetic conditions, you were forced to near maximum oxygen usage. Every other aspect of the space was gone except if you had almost near maximum oxygen. In order to metabolize the rates that were at the uptakes that were observed. And why that was interesting is that there's potentially a clinical meaning to that, which is that ischemic events that restrict oxygen in diabetics are much more likely to be fatal. And even this kind of an approach where you just applied it to the mitochondria and cardiac myocyte provided a potential mechanistic explanation for that. We couldn't say, conclusively that that's what it is, but it provided like a really beautiful example of that. Another thing that it did, and this would make a lot more sense if you were seeing the data, but what it also said was that for diabetics, pyruvate dehydrogenase flux was pushed near zero. There were no solutions for it other than trivially low solutions. And that was interesting because in data from microarrays back then, pyruvate dehydrogenase was one of the highest differentially expressed genes found between diabetic cardiac myocytes and non-diabetic when they were derived. And what was interesting about the model is that it could differentiate the fact that that was, and so some people said, well, maybe we have to overexpress that. Maybe that's a failure. But what the model said was that that was not true because you could express pyruvate dehydrogenase a million-fold and it wouldn't make any difference because you can't balance substrates to run through it. So what it gave you was insight into the notion that the that when the cell was downregulating pyruvate dehydrogenase under those conditions, that was in fact that's the correct thing to do in that space, right? It's the correct response. And so every time you're analyzing data, like in those scenarios. You want to establish what is, something bad that's coming as a cause of the disease, right? What's the driver? What are the downstream consequences of that? And what are all the changes that are associated with a correct response of the cell trying to deal with what has happened? And that model was interesting because it was a very simple model, but it actually said pyruvate dehydrogenase downregulation falls into the third category. Anyway, so there's a bunch of interesting things you can do once you start narrowing down on those spaces. Does that make sense? That's a long answer to your question.
Yeah. So is it fair to say that if you have sort of mild constraints, you often do constrain particular parameters that you can name and sort of understand that?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, if you just go in there and you just randomly sample like your solution space without any measured constraints, it probably isn't that useful. But if you've made some measurements, and the nice thing about that kind of approach is you go as far as your measurements will take you, but not further. You're not making any other assumptions. You're not biasing yourself anywhere. You're just saying from these measurements, this is how it constrains the space. That's what I know. I don't know more than that. That's what I know. And I really like that aspect of it. Okay. So as I was mentioning yesterday, man, I was really worried when I was preparing these lectures that I had too little, and I was really wrong. Great questions. I really appreciate it. Okay, so we have predictions for modified strains. So one of the other things you can do is that once you have a model that's reasonably accurate, then you can start to modify and make predictions about how modifications to the network would affect its function. So this was a very interesting work from, again, the Paulson group. This is really a classic Nature paper, I think one of the most important in the history of this field. And what they did was look at oxygen uptake rate, glycerol uptake rate, and growth. And so this was in a naive strain. It doesn't typically grow on glycerol. That was an unusual substrate. And what you see are the experimental points are all suboptimal, and they're kind of scattered about. And then what they did was to evolve this over the course of 60 days, just passing it to optimize so that it could be under selection pressure for optimum growth rate. And it actually clustered beautifully right along the line of optimality. So this was one of the first indications that this kind of an approach could predict the end of an evolution. Basically, right, what that meant is that they were able to go through this process of taking the network reconstruction, applying the constraints, defining the solution space, finding the optimal solutions, calculating the phenotypic phase plane, and then watching that evolution mesh up. And this is just a different view of that. And this are the growth rates. So this was the predicted growth rate, maximum growth rate that should have been possible for the cell. And so as it evolved, and look, this is over the course of 40 days, right? So it took a while, right? It had to search its sequence space, had to optimize, but you can see that it comes up here. And then once it hits its predicted maximum, it stays stable then for the next 20 days. And you can see this on the phenotypic phase plane again, how it clusters to the line of optimality. So day zero, you can see it's kind of all in this particular part of the phase plane. And then over time, it lines up beautifully. And so this was really a nice example that you could predict the endpoint of a complex process of an adaptive evolution. There are also approaches for model-guided cellular engineering. One of the most popular and kind of foundational ones was something called OpNoc. And so essentially what you're doing here is you have your wild type, and then you simulate, in this case, knockouts. There are other approaches where you can add in new pathways. You can do a whole bunch of things, but just for simplicity's sake, let's look at a knockout case, where For example, if you have an objective function, so here the cell objective is shown as being to the right, and you have an engineering objective, you're trying to make some biofuel or something, and that's up. So in this case, if you have a solution space that looks like this, and this is a projection, right, of that high dimensional space into two dimensions, if it looks like this, then the cell to grow optimally essentially won't make your product, right? So you're fighting the cell in this case. And what you want to do is to search and try to identify a knockout or some set of knockouts where you eliminate this part of the space and you leave yourself a part of the space that looks like this, so that now as the cell maximizes its growth, it's forced to make your cell. So what you're trying to do is to take your cell's objective and your objective and align them in the same direction. And if you can achieve that, then you're essentially harnessing the power to work of evolution to work on your problem rather than against your problem. Okay. So this is really a neat approach. So I was just showing that. So that's op-knock, right? So op-knock mutant A here would show here. This would give you an optimum byproduct, a lower amount of product, but with faster growth rate. This would be an example of, say, a different op-knock, which would give you higher byproduct secretion rate and lower your growth rate. There's also a number of other approaches that are used. One of them is called MoMA. This came out of George Church's lab. This was Dan Segre's work when he was a postdoc there. And in that case, what it does is it predicts when you do a knockout. So the knockout here would move to this space here. And then it predicts that there's a minimization of the change of fluxes so that it would move perpendicular to this new space. So MoMA would predict that the cell would optimize, would go here. FBA would predict here, and there's a lot of different work that's been done on comparisons there. Typically in the short run, MoMA is a little bit more accurate than LP, but it's a little debatable. It varies somewhat from case to case. Okay. And then you can also add a bunch of different kinds of constraints. We already talked about this loop law constraint. This is getting rid of these type 3 loops that I mentioned. And we already mentioned dynamics, so I think those have all been covered. So we have, also there's a lot of tools that people can use. There's what's called the COBRA toolbox, COBRA standing for Constraint-Based Reconstruction and Analysis. You can download that at Bernard Paulson's website. Here's the paper associated with it, and there's also a resource known as Cobra Pi. So this toolbox is in MATLAB, and you can get a lot of the same tools now in Python in something called Cobra Pi. So if you're interested in implementing these models, there are a lot of available resources where you can run them fairly simply. Open source, yeah. All right, so summary from day one. So we have reconstructions of biochemical networks provide chemically and genetically accurate databases. We have an analysis of network properties as a means to query those databases, determine systems properties. These big genome scale models are really a key to drive large scale hypothesis science. And what I mean by that is that the models essentially are a large scale hypothesis, right? So there's no way for you to state in a sentence, here's my hypothesis about how the metabolism of E. coli operates. But a model does that. And so models are really the key to tying together discovery science and hypothesis-driven science. Okay, and then the development of these methods allows us to interrogate the genotype to phenotype relationship in complex ways. Okay, so let's talk a little bit now about modeling integrated gene regulatory and metabolic networks. So we have multiple different network types, right? Gene regulatory, signaling, metabolic, they all operate within the cell. Of course, there are more than just this. And one of the key challenges in doing modeling of this kind is that we get different biological networks. And these different biological networks are typically modeled with different approaches. Okay, so gene regulatory networks are tend to be modeled a lot differently than, say, metabolic networks that we've been talking about. And so they speak different languages, so how to translate and integrate effectively. So most gene regulatory networks are more on this side of being statistical models, right? Maybe you have some sort of linear regression, or you've got some sort of machine learned view of how certain transcription factors may affect the expression of certain genes, in contrast to the biochemical reaction networks we've been talking about for the last couple of days. And then we can integrate both approaches together to provide a mechanistic content for high-throughput data. All right. So we already just walked through this process of constraint-based modeling, so I won't go through that again. On the gene regulatory side, typically we're looking at something that's, it can be somewhat mechanistic, it's usually a little more statistical. Typically you constrain these models based on, say, ChIP-ChIP or ChIP-seq that gives you a universe of possible interactions, and then typically people learn across gene expression data or similar how to, you know, if something is looks like it's a positive regulator or a negative regulator or so forth. We can go, we'll go into that in too much detail. So all of the regulation of genes imposes constraints also on metabolism, right? One of the most obvious ones is that at the endpoint of a lot of these genes is that the genes encode for the enzymes that carry out the reactions in metabolic functions, right? So that's one of the most straightforward ways that the gene regulation impinges on metabolism. So there's a number of methods that exist for integrating regulation and metabolism. Sort of the two main ones that I'll bring up here is RFBA. There's actually a corrected version, SRFBA. The SRFBA is a correction based on the fact that, as I mentioned, that linear program gives you one solution and not all the solutions. But I'll just introduce RFBA here today briefly. RFBA essentially uses Boolean regulatory rules. So it's based on either transcription factor or metabolite presence. So in essence, you come in and reaction 2, for example, will happen only if transcription factor 1 is on, for example. Transcription factor 1, maybe if not ATP or it's related to some, it needs to be phosphorylated or something. And so in essence, but basically you're just saying that under certain conditions, not all metabolism is expressed, right? It might be repressed in the presence of oxygen, for example, or whatever. PROM, which is a method that was developed in my lab, it instead does probabilistic links between transcription factor absence and reaction flux. So instead of having a Boolean relationship, you learn a probability for that's associated between a transcription factor, say, not being expressed, and an enzyme either being or not being expressed, and then you simulate its effect on a reaction. Okay, so we'll go through that. So, so RFBA, as I mentioned, and these are slides related to a Marcus Covert's paper in Journal of Theoretical Biology when he was in Bernard Paulsen's group. So in essence, you have, and this is his toy system, and so basically you have a set of reactions. And then for some of them, you just have a Boolean regulatory rule, as I mentioned, right? So in this case, if not regular regulated protein B or whatever. You also have your regulatory proteins, right? And this, so RPO2 is expressed if oxygen is not present and so forth. And you can read these in a variety of different ways, and I won't go through this in too much detail. But what happens then is under certain environmental conditions, then a certain subset of the network would be available to be operated on, while the other would be turned off by regulation. And then as that regulatory states change, then the network that is actually available changes. And this matters a lot because otherwise your simulations can be really biased. You could, if there's a set of pathways that's downregulated in the presence of oxygen, then you don't want those to be available to your simulation if oxygen is present and so forth. Okay, so RFBA has a number of strengths and some limitations. So it describes regulatory effects of active and inactive activators and repressors, and it can model feedback between transcriptional regulation and metabolism. So it does allow you to simulate a lot more elements than what we could do with just FBA alone. Now limitations are that it requires manual curation of regulatory associations. No one's really been able to come up, including myself, because I tried to come up with ways to automate these Boolean rules. We tried it in my lab unsuccessfully. It accounts only for direct regulators of reaction, so it doesn't account for indirect regulation. It doesn't really account for biological uncertainty, because the Boolean rule, it's either there or it's not there, right? It's yes or no. And it uses an arbitrary flux computation rather than all possibilities. And that's something that is corrected in what's SRFBA, which was developed in Eitan Rupin's group. Okay. So because of some of these reasons, we developed something called probabilistic regulation of metabolism, or PROM for short. And our goals with this were to develop something that would be automated, comprehensive, so it would relate to all the genes. The other aspect of that is that the Boolean RFBA models, because they've been manually constructed, are not as global. They're a ton of work. I watched Marcus work on it for about, you know, for well over a year, just building out those rules. So here then in PROM, we're going to simulate what happens when you knock out a transcription factor, and we're going to have a continuous flux restriction. So this isn't going to be on or off. You're going to be able to have a dimmer switch, essentially, from 100% down to 0%. RFBA, in contrast, will have either the reaction's either there or it's not there, and then you just take the subset that's there and you run FBA. Okay. All right, so just like I said, RFBA, so it would say if transcription factor B is present, then reaction A is present. Whereas what we would learn is the probability that enzyme A will be expressed, given that transcription factor B is expressed, say is 95% or whatever it is. Okay, so this probability then, so probability A equals 1, B equals 0, this is the probability that gene A being on when the transcription factor B is off, and probability of A being on when B is off. So PROM is sort of based on the notion of probabilistic Boolean networks in a sense. It's because we do still assign, we are going to use a cutoff and assign a probability. So it's a probability for being on or off. And I'll explain that in just a minute. This we thought was important because there's not a perfect correlation by any means between transcription and flux. There's a number of ways that we try to estimate probabilities in sort of a coarse-grained way here. And this is by no means the final solution. This is just a step forward, I hope. So how PROM works then? So we have our enzymes here, and they catalyze reactions. And we have transcription factors, say, that have some sort of regulatory effect on the enzymes. And so what we compute then is the probability that enzyme 1 will be expressed given that, an exclamation point here means not, so just like in C, I suppose, but you've got and not, not G. So if G is knocked out, then what's the probability that enzyme 1 will be there, right? So the probability of the enzyme 1 being on given that gene is off. And how we estimate that is we just estimate it from gene expression data. Okay, so we just take, maybe 1,000 gene expressions or several hundred gene expression profiles. You take the number of samples with the transcript for the enzyme being on and G being off, divided by the number of samples with G equal off. So it's just counting probabilities, very simple. Right? And then we just get an estimate for those probabilities. So in this case, maybe we have a probability of this enzyme being expressed of being on when the gene is off of 80%, for example. And maybe the second one is more of a weak association. So its probability, if gene isn't expressed, there's only a 10% chance, say, of that one being on. Okay, and so you just learn these probabilities. And we wanted to do this in a way that we could do it from high throughput data, so it would be comprehensive and it would be automated. This is the first a semi-automated approach for building these kind of networks. Okay, and then you can simulate then what happens in the case of knocking out any of these transcription factors by just applying these rules. So we do this across, we do this for every enzyme. So you do it for every enzyme, for every transcription factor. Yes, yeah, so you build this out globally.
But there won't be any TFTF interactions.
We don't, the current version of PROM, or I should say this initial version of PROM, doesn't do all the transcription factor interrelationships. So basically, we assume that all those get integrated down into whatever is here at the end. You can build that out in more complicated ways. And in fact, we have a paper under review right now that integrates PROM with an approach from Nitin Baliga's group called EGRIN, which is a gene regulatory inference method. So that new approach, which we call iDream, is that one will do a lot more of that kind of thing. So look for that very soon. Okay. Let's see. Just have two minutes left. Okay. So I already kind of talked through strengths and of limitations of RFBA. So for PROM, strengths are that regulation effect is inferred from data. Okay. So that so it doesn't require a lot of manual curation. It accounts for at least some degree of biological uncertainty. And it describes partial inactivation. In other words, you have a dimmer switch all the way between 0 and 100%. That's the big positive. Limitations is that really it's good at predicting primarily inactive transcription factors. It's not really an approach for overexpression, although we do have a new paper that just came out a couple weeks ago in PLOS Computational Biology on tuberculosis. And that one has a new tweak to the method that does allow you to do overexpression. Limitations, it describes only direct regulators, so we haven't yet put in all the other interconnections. That comes out more in this new iDream approach that will come out soon. And it doesn't explicitly incorporate combinatorial regulation, which I was just mentioning. So the way this works then is we start with our basic flux balance equation. And unfortunately, this uses different terminology, but we maximize. This is just weighting, so this is the same as that C vector before. So we maximize a weighting, S times V equals zero, subject to our balance. It's our basic flux balance. And what we add to it is that you add this penalty function. So based on those probabilities, you assign a loose restraint, basically, which is our loose form of a word for constraint, because if you predict that there's a small possibility, like a 10% chance of an enzyme being regulated, that's not, it doesn't mean it's not there, right? It doesn't mean that its total flux act, you know, has to be at 10%. And so what we do is we apply this, and then when we find an optimal solution, and we minimize the amount that we go out of this. So you can go higher than this level, but you incur a penalty for doing it. And so you minimize the amount that you go out of these particular bounds. And that's what's shown here. Oh, these are just each different reactions. So reaction 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then this would just be the flux, either in a positive or a negative direction. And then red here is showing the probability that we find from PROM. So we think that this one is likely to have low flux in this direction. We think this one is likely to have higher flux. And so we would be biased to try to find solutions that look like that. Does that make sense? I'm going a little fast because, well, I'm actually out of time all right now. I just saw. Okay, anyway, so that gives just a brief view of how the regulatory models work. I know that was a pretty quick treatment. Happy to take more questions tomorrow or during the break. Yeah, let me pop this back up. Okay, so which one?
Backwards, maybe a couple of slides. Yeah.
Okay.
So now your PTE1 equal to on, do you have any Do you factor in any prior probability for it as a baseline, which might be relevant if you have, say, more than one candidate for that particular step in your network? If I'm being clear, or probably not.
I'm not sure I totally get it. So we don't, there isn't any particular prior, it's just learned straight from data. We do, I mean, I guess the prior information or the information we use is just that there is, in fact, you know, some sort of chip or chips, you know, like there's some data that tells us that this may be a regulator for intrinsic, you know, for enzyme one. But we constrain the number of these that we'll consider. Like if we don't have, we don't do an all versus all comparison, so it's got to be constrained by that. So if that's what you mean by prior, we definitely do that. But then after that, it's just a function of analyzing the data.
All right, thanks.
Yeah.
How do we account for them?
Yeah, that...
So in a system, not all transcription factors are activated at the same time. Some remain dormant and they are activated upon a particular condition only. So how do we account for dormant transcription factors in case of PROM?
Yeah, so in the case of, so for PROM, we would be looking at, it's really a good question. So you can put extra layers of that incorporate the transcription factors that are related to different environmental conditions. And in fact, you really have to do that. So in the PROM models, like what we did for yeast, there are a limited number of environmental variables that are associated with that. So we haven't worked that out super extensively, but you're absolutely right, because you have to incorporate to some degree how those transcription factors are related to the environment. No, it's a really good point. Yeah.
TE1 is an enzyme which is coded by a gene, say G1. So there may be scenarios wherein G1 is activated by multiple genes.
Yes.
So that is not taken into account here, right? You're
that's not
basically
in this first iteration of PROM. It's not taken into account. It's basically, those things are assumed to be captured across all the different gene expression data that you're going through, because you have multiple of those that are given. That's one of the limitations I mentioned, is that we don't actually explicitly account in the first version of PROM for combinatorial regulation. The new iDream approach is better at that because we incorporate explicitly from this Egrin algorithm more complex regulation and then mediate it through PROM basically and put those together. So that newer approach does that better. Maybe I'll talk about that a little tomorrow. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So that you could do in different ways. We've done it pretty arbitrarily, which is we just take a histogram of all the gene expression and say the bottom 25% is off and the rest is on, I think is how we did it. Some just very generic cutoff. We tried a variety of different cutoffs and it wasn't overly sensitive within that range. And I could dig up that plot that shows kind of where that comes at. But it was a pretty simple approach in the first one. Thanks, everyone.